Welcome to the Watchdog Report. I'm your host, Ed Ciffone, Yorktown Watchdog, and President of the United Taxpayers of Yorktown, community activist group. I want to thank you all for watching. Tonight, I'm going to go into my guest right away so we can find out about her and what she's running for. Kim Izzarelli.
It's like Izzarelli.
That's close enough. Okay. So Kim, now...
pleasure to be here.
Okay, yeah. He kind of blasted in my ear, these things, so I'm trying to get my
See,
myself
I don't have one of those. So.
Yeah, which is good. So Kim, you're running for office. What office are you running for?
I'm running for the 95th District Assembly seat.
Assembly seat, yep. Okay.
The new 95th.
New York State, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, now first, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, sure.
And then why you're running for this
Absolutely.
Office.
For those of you who don't know, I am a resident of Briarcliff, which is in the town of Ossining. I'm running on the Republican line. We will find out maybe a little bit later this month about the conservative and independence lines. I've interviewed for those as well. I'm running because we need some new blood and some vitality and energy to represent our district in Albany. My opponent has been in office for 20 years. We happen to live in, as you probably know very well, one of the highest real property tax areas of the state, not the country. And interestingly, my opponent chairs the committee for the same. So,
property tax.
So, I really have a very strong fiscal conservative approach. I think we are in a very, very difficult time here in New York, where the reality is hit. 2008 was a meteor hitting the earth. $1 trillion of wealth left this planet. Wow. And that does not happen without some repercussions. And for us here living very close to New York City, wow, and the state being very hinged to revenue from Wall Street, i.e. income tax revenue, we're having a really tough time, and we will continue to do so for the next few years. So we have to get used to living differently. We mm-hmm. have to get used to doing things differently in government. Well, and that's why I'm running.
Okay, because I nominated Steve Katz
two years ago. Okay.
And they had it.
Also the Republican.
Republican, yeah. And they endorsed somebody else, the Republicans, okay? So now he's going to be running again. He's been 2 years.
Right.
So I'm just telling you that you should hook up with some of the people that already experienced how they're, you know,
well,
they ran
a
campaign.
Well, I do know Steve very well.
Oh, okay,
and
great.
I also know Bob Castelli, who's
also a very fine
assemblyman.
Great.
And, you know, I think we it's good for Westchester to have some strong people for a change representing the interest of Westchester. I mean, we really sort of became the ATM of the rest of the state. And when things were good, maybe that was okay. But we really need to go essentially on a fiscal diet.
Well, a team always works out better, you know?
Undoubtedly.
Is this the first time you're running for office?
Well, actually, no. I ran for the town of Ossining to be a council member. I haven't been elected, but to answer your true question here, but the town of Ossining, I ran for the village of Briarcliff, our trustee for a couple of times, and a school board somewhere here and there. But I've really, really been involved very heavily as a civic leader, as a volunteer. I serve on a number of boards actively,
great.
And all related to public service. And you know, budgeting. So
well, that's that's what the United Taxpayers, community activists, just public service people, we're just volunteers.
Right.
But we're trying to get out the information.
Right.
So let's just see, what is your platform? What do you want to change?
Well,
okay, or what do you want to do?
I absolutely love to talk about that, but I would just like to say for your viewers mm-hmm. that I have a really extensive retirement plan, pension, employee benefits background. And almost 70% of every dollar that you spend in government goes to some form of compensation.
Right, benefits, I know.
And it's one of these funny things that you see, that there's a lot of discussion about you know, what should we reuse the uniforms or something like that? Not to say it's not important, or you know, what happens to the police radios when we're done with them and how do we dispose of them? Not to say that's not important, but we focus on minutia and we don't look at the big picture. And this has been a real problem in New York State because, as you know, compensation and pension padding in the past has been a real issue. It grows exponentially. And we're
Well, that's this legislator. Do you know what they get? Do they get a pension because it's a part-time job? Mm-hmm. Do they get health care?
Yes. And interestingly, a legislator in New York State works 3 days a week for 6 months a year and receives basically a full person, full package of benefits. And in my view, and in my take on this, is I'm going to Albany, I'm representing you, taxpayers, the residents of our district. Like, you live in Yorktown, so I shouldn't say you. But you know what I mean by that.
What is the district?
It's Ossining and Briarcliff, Cortland, Peekskill, which includes Verplank, Montrose, Buchanan, Garrison, Cold Spring, Phillipstown, Nelsonville, Kent. I feel like the Metro North conductor here.
So it's hundreds of thousands of voters there, right?
Yes, it's over 100,000 people in population. So.
Yeah, because that did every 10 years they get redistricting.
That's right.
Is this why it's the new 95th district?
Well, it actually ended up going to a judge, the decision where the lines for the districts would be. However, we won't be revisiting that until 2022. So there was a built-in, I guess if we should say, drag your heels on the part of the legislature that the decision would made as it was, or ended up to be, and everybody sort of had kind of the piece of pie that they like cut for themselves, and a little bit of job security built in, by the way. Look, I have confidence that my constituency or my future constituency will understand what the real issues are, and I'm not intimidated or deterred by the fact that, you know, look, on both sides of the aisle here, Republicans got some nice districts and so did Democrats, but the public wasn't served. And, you know, as a person coming into this, I'm going to work very hard. I'm going to take the hits. I'm going to, you know, take the challenges. Right. But it's not going to stop me.
Yeah. Okay. So that's good. Now, the thing is that this person's been 20 years, your opponent?
That's right.
Okay. Now, she has some kind of record, right?
That's right.
Okay. Now, I don't know. Has she done anything in 20 years? Well, since she's your opponent, you must be looking at her and studying her, what her record is.
I do. And I will say this for my opponent. And I really want to spend some time talking about myself here and not really, you know, but I will say, for anyone to dedicate that much of their life to public service is very admirable. And I'm sure she's worked very hard. And I would also say that there was a time in New York State through the 80s and 92, when my opponent came into office, where time was, you may want to shut that door.
Yeah. Dennis, please shut the door.
Thank you. There was a time in New York where, I was just getting a little feedback on myself, where we were flush. You know, there was a lot of, Wall Street was doing very well. There was a lot of tax revenue. We kind of got used to living that life very comfortably. And it may not been that hard to be a legislator then. You didn't have to make the tough decisions that you have to make today that, frankly, not everyone always likes to hear sometimes. But we're all going to have to take part.
In the assembly, the Republicans are a minority. So that's rough. Do you have any idea about that, how you feel? That, you know, if you go in and be one more Republican in the legislation, because it looks like, you know, if you are the majority, you get what you want done.
Well,
you know, I don't know how many bills the Republicans have passed in the...
In 40 years have gotten out of
committee.
Four
in 40 years?
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. That's ridiculous. So you see, that's what I'm saying.
And I think everyone needs to be aware of that out there, that, yeah, you know, we're really sponsoring something in Albany that may not really be working for all of us, and that needs to change. Look, I can see that if we can embrace the issues that are out there, having a more moderate Republican agenda, having a more fiscally conservative Democratic agenda, and you could have some, you know, working between the sides.
That's what you have to do, work with Governor Cuomo.
So absolutely.
Okay,
there's no way you can get anything done unless you do that.
Right, that's great.
But to just say, you know, I'm just a lone Republican in the Assembly, well,
that's good.
I would never take that approach. I'm going to work very hard.
You need compromise, and you need communications, all that stuff.
And you have to work together.
And work together and accomplish the goals.
Right.
So that, now, you know, you hear all the time, tax relief. I don't like tax relief. I like tax reform.
Okay.
Okay. Now, do you have any ideas how to lower taxes using reform instead of relief? Because reform is forever. Relief is for, you know.
One thing that we need to do in New York State, and this is really giving local governments tools to do their jobs, local school boards, and the county and the local municipalities, villages,
right,
towns, we really need to accept the fact that the next 5 years are going to be extremely difficult in New York State. We are taking a huge hit in the revenue. Our expenses are going up. Our contractual expenses, we know they're there. And one of the things that we can do to control that growth is to repeal the Triborough Amendment.
Okay, so explain what the Triborough Amendment is.
It allows, if a contract has expired,
okay,
a public union contract has expired, it allows the growth to continue on the schedule, salary schedules that are in place at the end of the contract. So for example, if I'm getting 4% annual step increases, those will continue in place even though there isn't a contract in effect anymore.
That's the deal. You know, with the school system had the steps. In Yorktown, we have 16 steps, okay? So even though they took a 1.9% and a zero increase, and then the steps are in there.
It still goes forward.
Yeah.
And,
oh, wow.
And look, I just want to be clear.
How do you change that, though? Is that going to be a state?
It would have to be statewide.
Statewide, mm-hmm, amendment to?
Yeah. We would go back to the Triborough Doctrine for a limited period of time or
a
fixed period of time. That would be what the legislation would need to craft. But it needs to happen soon because we have some
salary, benefits, pensions,
ahead.
All that stuff is part of that?
Not everything. No, those things would stay in place. This is the automatic increases that are built in. Continue in autopilot even though the contract isn't in place anymore. So you're not changing what you've agreed to.
Right, but that's not
in terms
good.
Of benefits.
How do you stop it from
Well, that is good for turning whose point of view.
Yeah.
But I think there's some middle ground here that it can work, and how do you stop it? My answer would be, how do we move forward? How do we get buy-in? How do we collectively embrace the fact that we're really not in a good place right now, and we need all New Yorkers to join together to work?
Some history, you know, it's like a pendulum swings back.
Sure.
So I know we don't want to mention this, but as a Republican, I'm hoping that it starts from the top, from the president, a change. Okay, and it keeps on going because we cannot afford this $1 trillion. Just, I always see that meter going up.
It's frightening, isn't it?
Yeah.
A couple of things. One is I think about my kids a lot. I have a 12-year-old and a 14-year-old.
Okay, great.
And I think about, you know, when I was that age, I looked into the future and it was full of possibilities. And my parents just said, you know, just work hard, graduate college, and things will come to you, you'll get a job and so forth. I don't know if I can promise my kids that future, and that frightens me.
Maybe that's why you're running.
And that's why I'm running. I need to do that. I really need to know that when I'm not here, that they're not left with my debt and your debt and everyone
else
out there. It's a really important thing that we address this in our lifetime, not leaving it for the next generation to figure out. But you already have kids coming out of school in their 20s, early 30s, who are not working. You already have a generation of people that have retired earlier than they planned to retire,
right, yeah,
that don't have the skill set to go into the jobs that are needed right now. And so, you know, we need to make, just getting back to your inference to Mitt Romney, we really need to make a culture or a society that understands or is built towards developing, want a work ethic, but the conditions to, well, to rebuild our economy.
Well, that's a Republicans now. And big business, small businesses, you get people working, okay? And you reduce taxes.
And we all prosper.
And everybody,
and
okay.
It does. It,
simple
just
as that.
It's a basic, fundamental, you know, part of how an economy works.
Right.
There's no quick fix. A lot of people say to me, oh, well, you know, if we get behind this tax or cigarette tax or casino or da, da, da. You know, we have to get off of living on the add-ons or the extras or the
right,
one-times. We need to build a system that really works and puts people back to work.
And we had it. It was called capitalism, you know? Everybody's working. Everybody pays taxes.
Right.
Everybody has food. You can live in your house.
Right.
Right now, seniors, I don't know how they're surviving on a fixed income. I don't have young people who bought homes maybe 5 or 6 years ago
right,
are surviving.
Right.
You know, and then you have to make adjustments. Maybe you don't go on a trip anymore.
You do. You give up things, and,
yeah,
and I know.
College, what's college? $31,000 a year?
Sometimes $50,000, $60,000
a year.
You know? So each person, wow, I'm not going to say anyone's pain is any, you know, greater or less, but we all, for this country, for this state, which I love the Empire State, we're going to have to come together and make some hard decisions and get through this period of time, which will allow us to have prosperous 2018-19, 2020.
A couple years back, when the stock market was doing really well,
right,
during the Clinton time, there was 6 years that we didn't have to pay pensions to New York State. And some of the towns and villages, they spent that money, some
right,
of them kept them,
right,
and it had the surplus, the fund balance,
right,
okay? And it was going to happen again, you know?
Yeah.
And the state, I always liked this guy, Carl McCall, because he diversified everything. He was a Democratic, and he was in control.
Right.
Okay? And he was on top. Listen, we don't need the money. We'll give it back to the people.
I wouldn't completely agree with you on that point.
Okay. Okay, go ahead.
I think we can agree to disagree on some things,
okay,
even though we're both
well,
on
great,
the same
yeah,
side of the aisle here. But I think, I will say first, I come from a state cop family. Both my brothers are state cops. My dad was a state cop.
Oh, please, yeah,
my
I'm a
little brother just myself. My little brother just retired. But the point is that, you know, in the 60s and the 70s, we could offer some very generous benefits,
right,
because pay wasn't what it was now, and there was a good trade-off there. But more importantly, you had maybe 6 or 7 people working for every person retired. Okay, back
oh,
then.
Right, right, right.
Now my children, you know, 2020, 2030, in the years coming up, you will have 3 people working for everyone retired. So we don't have, and this is what we're really, what's really striking us now is
yes,
we
bad,
don't have the economic base, people working to support all the taxes that need to be paid to pay those kind of really generous pensions. And my dad, God bless him, and if you Google my name, there's an article in the Wall Street Journal where my dad and I are having a dialogue, actually, about
oh, yeah,
this,
oh, okay,
which is really funny, interesting. But he would say he always paid in something, and he was glad that he did that,
right,
because it gave him a better retirement, one.
Right.
But two, I think all of us should be responsible for some portion of our health care and some
right,
portion of our retirement, just because we own it.
Yeah, that's simple.
And we might disagree on that point.
No, I don't
but,
disagree.
But it works. And
right,
furthermore, when you own something, you watch it. You know,
right,
it's not
yeah,
somebody else's headache. I know when I get my statements, I look at everything. It's all there. Okay, I'm good. I'll put it in a file and put it away. We all should be doing that.
Yeah, yeah.
It shouldn't be, you know, some guy up in Albany's job to figure out how got the beans in the right jar.
Well, see, the other thing is that the local governments don't go to Albany. I don't see, you live in Briarcliff. You ever hear of the school board going to Albany?
Well, they do actually.
Oh, they did finally now because they have this association, school board association, $324,000.
I think each community, first of all, and I really am a small government girl, and I'll tell you why. Because I think we live in a community because we like it. We like, you know, you like the shops, you like how your stores. Peak School, I think, is a real, you know, up-and-coming community. It's every time I drive down here, I'm just amazed. A new restaurant. Each community should have the right to decide how that community's run and how this community's, how the community school operates. Okay, here's an example. When people are evaluated in a school district, one community might decide that's information that's proprietary. They want to keep how their students are doing. Maybe that's information they want to keep to themselves. My opponent sponsored a bill that throughout the whole state, all that information would be kept under lock and key. Yes.
Well, she was a teacher, right?
Well, she was, but I'm not picking on them. I am just saying that I truly believe that if one community, Austin, wants to make one set of decisions and they want to run their community that way, they can. Maybe in Yorktown you want to do something differently. That's your right, your prerogative.
Right.
But, you know.
But you're missing one point.
Go ahead.
You have the local town.
Right.
You got the school.
Right.
And you got the county.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
Now, if the county's reducing stuff and the school is 70% of your tax base, and this is, that's the thing killing people when they're all together. So my next question to you, this cap. Now, I'm against all caps, okay? Because they wanted 4% a while back ago.
Okay.
Okay, now it's 2%. So they attach you to 2% when it's, I'm looking at it for zero.
Okay.
So here's my, I'm missing this question. What do you think about the cap? Was it a good idea? Is it a short-term thing? Or how do you feel about it?
I think, I disagree with you. I think the cap was a step in the right direction. Okay. I'm amazed that it took them as long as it did.
The
legislators are patting themselves on the back. Again, this is something they should have been doing. It's their job. But 2%, okay, it's not zero, which would have made you happy, but 2% is a start. Here's your problem. Okay. Your contractual increases in many cases for the county and for many of the municipalities and school districts are 4%. So you already had a cap that's lower than what you already know you're going to have to pay. And that's a problem. You know that money's going to have to come from someplace else. Now what's happening right now is you've got really, and this is sort of the plain ugly truth, a lot of people that are living off their fund balance, which simply means there are communities, school districts that are really living off of the rainy day money they put aside for different emergencies or a little bit of, that they're allowed to keep on the side.
Where did they get that money from? You
well, I mean, they're legally entitled to keep it. And this is another place where we differ. So this is going on a different direction.
But my
point is that the would strengthen our communities, our school districts, our municipalities, our county, is a repeal of the Triborough Amendment because it would allow them the leverage that they need to go out, go to the collective bargaining process, and make some of the changes that need to be made to get compensation more in line with market. Okay? Because
when you talk about benefits, and I know we keep going back to the school, but you were on the school board?
No, I'm not. I'm on the audit committee, but I'm not on the school board.
Audit committee. And with your opponent, for the last 20 years, I've been trying to get rid of the teacher centers. Okay, and they got rid of the teacher centers last year.
Right.
But they came back with the teacher centers with a different name. Okay.
Right.
It was $31 million this cost, okay, and 121 of these teacher centers.
Right.
Teachers how to teach. They get credit. The credit turns into money, goes on to their retirement. Okay. So I thought it was gone, and now it's back by a different name. But again, what you're trying to say is that benefits should be looked at, you know, like if they did away with that. Say you had to go to accredited college instead of teacher centers, that would save a lot. I know I shouldn't go into this with the school stuff.
I just want to.
Because you've been on the school.
Yeah, and I want to just say one thing to that is that we we know in New York that we have to do a massive retooling of our schools. On both sides. I mean, teaching community and, you know, all the people that are watching this know, look, you have places in the state where you have a fraction of the classes that are college ready. And so we know we have to change. We have to do something differently. What's being proposed that might be the most cost-effective way to start to approach that problem. I'm not saying it's the best way. Maybe, you know, what you're saying, going to an accredited college, maybe removing tenure, maybe some of these things that aren't even on the table might be the best solution to get the best program or the best structure. But that's not in reality.
But that's communications. They talk it out.
Yeah.
And that's why you have unions. That's why you have
I understand
okay,
that.
So it works it out. Let me ask you this question. Look, I'm a proponent of lowering taxes. Okay.
Right.
Now, you know what the property tax is, right?
Right.
Everybody pays property tax.
Right.
Okay. Now, how do we stop the high property tax? They mentioned a circuit breaker in New York State. That
right.
means partially income tax.
Right.
Okay. Then you have sales tax.
Right.
Okay. And then let me see if I can. Okay. And the other thing is member money. You're going to hear about this. That there's 200 and something, 210 members of the legislature. They get $200 million
yeah.
to spend. Where do they get that from? The lotto. So
yeah.
again, and the last thing is the lotto.
Yeah.
So why can't they somehow combine that and lower taxes? See, this is what I've been preaching, so I have to preach a little bit on my show.
I thought you said you weren't going to talk.
No, but this is why I have to promote, because you're going to get in office and you're going
to
hear from me.
Okay. Well, I expect
so listen, to. So that's my last thing about me. Now,
do I get a chance to comment on that? Or?
Yeah, you can. Okay, because you have a couple minutes, and then you'll talk about yourself.
Okay.
That's
so, those are all potential options. Okay. Our issue in New York State, though, is that we really got hooked on a very extremely high amount of income tax revenue that's just not there anymore. Okay. We also got hooked on stimulus money. So it's kind of like, you know, if you like sugary cakes, and I need 3 cakes a day, now I only have 2, all right? And I'm still missing that third cake that I would like. It's gone. So I really need to look at the system and say, what do I need to do to make this work? Because I can be doing one-off things all the time. You know, casinos and da da da. Not that any of those things are great. That's a nice little pop, but it's not going to replace. And we may not ever be back, maybe 10 years from now, to being 3 cakes again. Okay?
Okay.
We need to learn to live on 2. That's the first thing.
Okay. Yeah.
Because I can't make up enough revenue to make what I really need. Okay? I need to learn to live on, just like in your household, learning to live on a limited amount.
All
so
right.
that. But do I have a couple more minutes left?
I only got one more.
Oh,
only
so unfair.
30
Go ahead.
Seconds, so just
all right.
Get, just say real quick.
All right, well, I certainly do appreciate having this opportunity to come on your show today.
Okay.
It's wonderful. And I'm looking forward to meeting each one of you when I'm out on the campaign trail, and certainly after I'm elected in November, I hope. My email and phone number will come up on a slide at the end of this, and I hope to hear from all of you if you have something to say. Love different points of view.
All right,
and
listen, thank you for
thank
coming.
Thank you.
See, time goes pretty quick.
It does, doesn't
calls.
It?
Listen, folks out there, don't forget that if you're in that district,
95,
go out there and vote, and there's no primary, but it'll be in November. I think it's November 8th, right? Is the general election? Yeah, I think, okay. So listen, don't forget to go out there and vote. United Taxpayers is still fighting for you. So thanks for watching, and good night.